if someone misses a step, they come down hard on their heel, that force is transmitted up their leg into this, where the hip bone meets with the sacrum, and these ligaments get stretched. Someone's in a motor vehicle accident, they know they're gonna get hit. They know they're gonna get hit. Why is that a difference? What do you do when you know you're gonna get hit? You put your foot on the brake, right? So you are pressing on that brake because you see the structure coming in front of you, or something coming in front of you, with all your might, and then boom! That whole force is transmitted up the leg to the sacroiliac. So again, repeating, so when you see someone who comes out of one of these injuries, who has complaints of back pain, don't just look at the discs, don't just look at the other structures, look at the sacroiliac, look at what else is in mind. When I was in medical school, we didn't necessarily implicate the disc as a cause of pain. We knew if the disc does something, like if it permeates out, we know that it did something or twisted the nerve. We know that if there's a fissure and the nucleus of the disc leaks out, that can do something to the nerve. We never thought that the disc itself would have a problem with the nerves inside the disc, so we know that's another cause. Because it's my job to help diagnose if that's part of the problem. Okay, so we've got, just to give you, there's nerves, we talk about the nerves outside the disc, there's nerves going into the disc. And you have disruption of the disc, as we talked about, those prostaglandins that leak out, the nerve. Discography is sometimes used if we want to study the particular disc. The same technology used for coronary angiograms. Same technology. You don't want to overpressurize the coronary artery because what will happen? A boom, it bursts. Same with the disc. When you're testing a disc, you're pressurizing it to a certain amount of strength. You don't want to overpressure it. You want to see if that disc functions normally or not. Spinal cord stimulation, and we're coming to the end. We know that the criteria to select a spinal cord stimulator is that there's a demonstrated pathology. They failed conservative therapy. Surgery is not indicated. So sometimes before I throw a stimulator, I will have the patient go back to the surgeon just to check one more time. There's no untreated drug addiction. So if someone has a drug problem, which most don't, but some do, we'll have them detoxed by a psychiatrist usually. We do get psychiatric parents or psychological parents, as I mentioned earlier, for the two reasons we don't want unrealistic expectation and make sure there's no underlying psychological issues. And a spinal cord stimulator is a very similar technology to what? What's the closest technology that's in medicine to a spinal cord stimulator? Pacemaker, right, same Medtronic. One of the biggest companies for pacemakers, one of the biggest companies for stimulators. It's a battery that emits a signal at a very precise wavelength, at a very precise frequency that helps lessen the pain. How does it do that? How does it do that? How does it work? The easiest way that is standing here, I can do it. If I smash my hand on this lectern, what's the first thing I'm going to do? Not the first thing I'm going to say. The first thing I'm going to do is go like this, right? We all done it. We rub the hand. Oh, you hit your shin. You hit your shin on a chair. Oh, fine, you just pop. Well, why do we rub it? We rub it because it confuses the brain. The brain now is not just getting that signal from where the sharp edge of the lectern or the chair that hits your shin is. It's getting signals that, wait, there's all kinds of things here, and now the pain is lessened. Same concept as the spinal cord stimulator. Exact same concept. So, failed back syndrome is an indication. CRPS or RSV or fibromyalgia, arachnoiditis, diabetic neuropathy, phantom limb pain, long-standing post-op pain. And the issue with the stimulator, what I tell patients, is that the fact that we're getting to the point of recommending a stimulator, and by the time we get to that point, most patients are receptive to it, it doesn't mean you're going to get it. Because what percentage of patients have a trial that doesn't work in a stimulator? About half. Okay, so half, we don't know why, but half of the patients who get a spinal cord stimulator trial don't get relief. and we just pull it out and we're done. It's just a perfect case. I would see the needle, very similar, just an epidural that you would pull out after 1 minute later, an epidural that you had after surgery. So we tell patients, you're in the driver's seat on this. We're going to put this in for 3 to 5 days through a needle. You tell us if it's giving you the relief you need or not. If it is, we'll implant it. If we don't, we're not going to do it. In Brazil, so I get invited to speak before the Brazilian Pain Society annually. They don't, for some reason, the insurance companies in Brazil don't approve the trial. So you've got half the patients in Brazil who have stimulators that say this is not helping, and half that say it's great. In this country, the trial is always approved, as it should be, and I think Brazil's going to change shortly as well. Where if the trial doesn't work, there's absolutely no sense in putting it in the room. So we talked again about treatment options, medications, opiates are last resort, the procedures that can be done to diagnose the source of pain. We didn't talk about physical therapy too much, but we do use it. And we use it when a patient is already getting out of their pain cycle. If we send someone to a physical therapist who's red hot, the therapist can't do too much. But as they're getting better, they've been deconditioned for so long that they need that therapy is beneficial. And then if we do send to surgery, and again, you'll be hearing an excellent speaker following me, if we send them a patient, they're going to know that this patient has worked up exhaustively. We'll give them our opinion on what structures are the problem ones, and then they can have a successful surgery. Again, when to consult, the sooner the better. And the reason is we want to diagnose it precisely, treat it, get rid of any inadequate pain relief. If they had any previous treatment failure, we want to address it. And then if they also have any excessive side effects from the present treatment they had before seeing us, we're going to talk about it and see what solutions we can do. So in summary, not acute pain is a complex problem. Pain science is advancing rapidly and allows us to sort out in a deductive and scientific way what's causing the pain. Interventional pain medicine is a distinct medical specialty, and for all of you in this room, always please think, is this doctor who's treating someone who's just using a lot of opiate narcotics, or are they really working to try to find the source of the pain? And the precise diagnosis and treatment is key. Multidisciplinary care is an option. As we talked about, we're done with sensory therapists, et cetera, if we don't succeed. In our treatments, we'll succeed in diagnosing and send to the surgeon. And I thank you very much for your attention.